Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Human Law Hangover question and answer presentation, Jesus answers questions from the audience about the material covered in the previous presentation, Human Law Hangover. Recorded on the 9th of November, 2016, in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Thanks, guys. Thanks for being patient with me while I go through these questions and just check them out. So this particular discussion is the Human Law Hangover Q&A. So basically we're asking lots of different questions about laws and our hangover about it, our attitudes and all those things. So, and it's great, the combination of different questions that some of you have come up with here. So we'll go through those. If we can start with Jada. Where are you, Jada? Yep. So we start, Mike, with Jada. And if we could also have a mic with Louise, where are you? You're on this side, aren't you? Yeah. Who's on this side? I'll just find someone on this side. Bruce, if we can have a mic with you after Jada. Now, I like both of your questions, Jada, so let's do them one at a time.
I had a number on
you. Well. You have two here.
Two.
Your very first two, by the looks, I think it is. The first one about measuring the laws by effects.
Yep. Is there a danger in measuring the laws by the effects as the human soul affects the effects? For example, like with quantum physics, they know that having an observer affects the outcome of the experiment.
Spot on. There is a danger, yes, of measuring the laws by the effects. Example of that would be, you know, humankind saying that it's appropriate that we eat meat because animals eat meat and we've always eaten meat and it's better for you to eat meat because you get more protein and you need protein in your diet. And that's an example of measuring the effects when we've already affected the effects. And so the logic of it is very flawed. And the problem with any flawed logic when we're analysing any law is that we're going to impose flawed logic on future decisions. So you're dead right, there is a danger in measuring laws by just the effects only. But the majority of time, we are completely ignoring effects, if we're honest. So, for example, with regard to the eating of meat, to allow the eating of meat for the sake of humans consuming protein, we're ignoring the damage that eating meat does to the planet. We're ignoring the damage it does to other environments. We're ignoring the fact that huge amounts of land is being cleared from oxygen-producing trees, which is actually damaging another area of our life. We don't have as clean air as a result of that. And so we're actually having to ignore a whole series of other effects in order to justify one effect. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So while there is a danger of measuring effects, and obviously, you know, quantum physics does allow for that danger to be observable, the reality is the majority of times our problem is not that we're measuring effects, but rather that we're completely ignoring all the effects. Mm-hmm. And that's a higher danger than attempting to measure effects. Does that make sense?
Yep.
So I would say that with regard to the question, there is a danger in the question, but it's a very low danger in comparison to the dangers that we actually engage by completely ignoring the effects of what we're doing. Yeah. And I feel eating meat's a great example of that, where we justify the eating of meat for the sake of human consumption of protein, while at the same time we're really ignoring all of these other very negative effects. And in fact, there's a huge amount of extinction events that occur on Earth as a result of the eating of meat. There's a huge amount, what I mean by that is that there's a large amount of animals and creatures that become extinct because of our destruction and the way we handle the land in order to produce beef, cattle in particular, and also lambs and pigs and all the other things we eat. And so there's an illustration, but there's also the removal of oxygen from the atmosphere, or the removal of the regeneration of the earth through the decay tree process from forests. And we're removing large amounts of that from the planet in order to eat meat. And so we ignore completely many things, and that is a higher danger. In fact, that's our extreme danger in comparison with the small danger of having some measurement errors. Mm. You know? So I feel we need to develop an attitude where we want to measure the effect. We measure the effect with the knowledge that our observation does change things, and we need to ensure that we've taken that into account. But that danger is much lower than the danger of not measuring the effect at all and completely ignoring large-scale effects just to justify globally a certain type of action. Yeah.
Yep.
Make sense?
Good, yeah.
Yep. The second question was, how is it?
Yeah, how is it that one person can discover and utilize a law and everyone can benefit, for example, flying, without each individual person having to learn the law for themselves?
Yeah, it's actually a wonderful thing God has allowed, because what it allows is for one person in the human race to discover something and everyone to benefit from that discovery. Now, the reason why it's allowed is because God actually has principles that allow it. So one of the principles of love is that every single discovery should be shared. And in fact, the laws of hierarchy and the laws of scope ensure that every single, and economy, all ensure that every single discovery should be shared, right? So this whole idea of having a discovery and then locking it under a key, like calling it intellectual property that you own, or and locking it away so that no other person can do it, is in direct disharmony with so many of God's principles. And so it's actually a good thing that one person can discover a law and that everyone can benefit. And God's made that purposefully. So the more people exist on the planet, the more chance there is to discover a new law. So the fact, so you imagine if we had one person living on the planet, he'd have to go through these experiments to discover laws, if he didn't do it with God, I'm talking about. He'd have to go through his own experiments to discover law, wouldn't he? Right? So what that means then, he's trying to discover through his own experimentation the law, and he has no other chance than his own effort to do so. But now you add a second person doing the same and a third person doing the same and 7 billion people doing the same. Now we have a chance to discover a whole series of laws that one person on his own wouldn't have the chance to discover. And isn't that a loving thing that God's done to allow that to occur? So that's why God allows it. Yeah.
Yep. It's wonderful, really. One more question about that.
Sorry, yeah,
with,
sure.
Let's just say the people who discovered aerodynamics.
Aerodynamics,
whatever,
yeah.
One of the reasons they were able to, because they wanted to help benefit others?
Yes.
Is that the only reason, one of the only reasons they were able to?
Most scientists are motivated by some quite pure desires when you think about it. Because many times they are motivated by the desire. They know that if they could discover this certain way of doing something, and if it actually turns out to be true, that large numbers of humanity would benefit from that discovery. Does that make sense? So yes, many times they have a seeking heart, like a really sincere seeking heart. On top of that, they have this desire to benefit not only themselves but also humanity. And as a result of that, they end up discovering things that they might not have discovered if they had different motivations. Mm. So that also is in harmony with the law of love as well. So that's why that is also encouraged by God. So God's not encouraging us to all continue living in the Stone Age, as some people would imagine, but rather God's encouraging us to discover more and more law, because God knows that the more law we discover, the more we'll be able to bring ourselves and our lives and everything else in our environment into harmony with what God has intended to be there in the long run. So that's going to benefit all of humanity, not just myself. But if I have an attitude that I am only going to discover law so that I can have fame or notoriety or adulation of people or whatever, and I also lock the law under lock and key and I just do my little thing with it and nobody else is allowed to do it with it, now I'm working against many of those principles. And so it's highly unlikely that I will, and humanity will benefit under those circumstances. So we see that happening on Earth too, with regard to things like even the AIDS virus, how, you know, while we're dealing with an effect there, a lot of the manufacturers of the vaccines that can help these sufferers, and many of these sufferers now are not are actually the people who perpetrated the virus, but rather who are the affected by others who are acted dishonestly with them. And yet here we go, we are charging such a high price for some of these vaccines that no one who really needs them, and that's a lot of people in the third world who really need them, are not given them. And that's because medicine manufacturers want to make a lot of money and make money for their shareholders. And now that is very out of harmony with the principles of love. Make sense?
Yep.
So there's examples on the planet where we're actually acting in more harmony with love, and then there's other examples where we're acting in the planet that's really out of harmony with love when it comes to finding new laws and engaging the principles of the law and then making substances or creations that will assist and benefit humanity from those laws. Yeah.
Thank you.
Good question, Australia. And Bruce, thank you. Your question I'll just go to, just hang a sec.
Actually, just on that, wouldn't like patents then be a unloving practice?
Yes, it is an unloving practice from God's perspective.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, Michael, is it unloving to question or oppose government's laws that are not in line with God's laws, or principles, and should we just accept that, you know, trust me, I'm from the government and I'm here to help you, as our collective condition, our society's collective condition in love is such.
So basically asking, should we do something about when we notice a law, a human law, is out of harmony with love, should we take some action about that, or should we just let it lie and let it be?
Yeah,
is really what you're asking, isn't it? Well, remember we've said that any time that human laws disagree or are in disharmony with God's laws, whose laws should we follow?
God's laws.
God's laws. So that being the case, if we do notice a human law is out of harmony with God's laws, what action should we take, do you feel? Now, it shouldn't be militant action, should it? Because automatically that would bring us out of harmony with God's laws. But we could at least take informative action, could we not? Where we inform people that that is out of harmony with God's laws and this is how it's out of harmony. So certainly we could do that, couldn't we?
Yep.
Yes. So we do need to take some action, don't we?
Okay,
if we're going to be in harmony with God's principles. Because we need to state what is harmonious with God's principles that we've... But we have to know that for certain, don't we?
Yeah.
Otherwise it's pointless exercise. But once we know it for certain, we would have to then state it, wouldn't we, where possible. So this is what happens with ourselves. On our website, we post, like I just made a comment, you just asked me the question about patents, and I said, yes, it's an unloving practice. Somebody asked me a question about, where you have children through IVF program. That's an unloving practice, and I've explained the reason why. Whether you keep doing it or not, it's up to you, but at the end of the day, it's an unloving practice, and there will be penalties because you're breaking God's laws if you do it. And there's reasons why that's happening. So I state quite clearly what I know to be an unloving law or an unloving practice. Many of us avoid doing that, though, because we are afraid of the
consequences
that might come back on us from people who believe in that practice.
The vaccination one's obviously one of them.
Which is a motion we do need to address. Yeah.
Thanks.
Yep. Good question. Okay. Can we go to Louise on this side? Thank you. Now you've got four questions you've put there. Well, actually more than four because there's two questions on some questions, but we'll do the first three, Louise, one by one. Is that okay?
Yep.
I should have enough time to do them all. We'll see how we go.
Why didn't you teach about God's laws and principles in the first century?
So just stop there.
Okay.
I did.
I thought you said the other day you didn't.
No, I just didn't do it in the way that I'm doing it here.
Uh-oh.
But I did, all the illustrations I gave, all taught God's laws, all of the illustrations I gave, every single comment I made was about one of God's laws and how it implied in society. I just didn't categorise them and collate them all together in such a way that we have in this program. Does that make sense? So it's not only being taught now, it has been taught for the last 2,000 years, don't think it hasn't. It's just been a bit different the way we've put this together in this particular program. Yeah.
So that answers the question, why is it only being taught now?
Correct.
Yeah.
It is, yeah, it yeah. does.
The next question, why has humanity not awakened to the concept of God's laws before?
Yep, so let's address that firstly. Humanity has awakened to the concept of laws. They just don't view them as God's laws. They view them as natural laws. So for example, humanity is awakened to the law of gravity and awakened to the law of aerodynamics. Now, I see them as God's laws, but they see them as natural law. Does that make sense? So they don't call them God's laws. They name them something different. But when it comes to awakening the concept of God's laws as it pertains to spiritual and emotional things, humanity has not awakened to that at this stage. So in other words, they're still quite closed to the concept that just like there is a physical law that has a cause and effect and a consequence and a reward, so too there are spiritual laws that have cause and effect and consequence and rewards. And so too there are emotional laws that have cause, effect, consequence and rewards. And the reason why, one of the reasons why humanity hasn't awakened to that is because they're not aware that God can actually measure emotions and measure thoughts and measure spiritual decisions through love. In other words, measure love. So they're not aware that God can do that, so they now believe that God can't. And so now they believe that there's no such thing as these emotional and spiritual laws. And it's only when they arrive in the spirit world that they become aware of many of them as a result. And what we're trying to do here is help people become aware that they exist and that there are ways, scientific ways, to discuss them and become aware of them and do something about them. Yeah. Yeah. But it is because we are very detuned to emotion as a result. We don't understand that God can measure emotion, and therefore we don't believe that God has laws that measure emotion and thought. Yeah. Yep. Next part of the question.
Will all of humanity embrace God's laws when they are tired of their pain and suffering?
I don't know. You know, as we talked about in our first assistance group, humanity is very tolerant of high levels of pain and suffering. We are very tolerant of high levels. Even in your own life, you think about it, oftentimes we've got to get a disease before we do something about anything, in our own body even. And so we're very tolerant of emotional pain and suffering. We're very tolerant even of physical pain and suffering. We're very tolerant of actions taken that harm others in society, very tolerant of them. And we are very tolerant of the violent, sexual and just emotional abuse of children, which is the source of many of these issues. So the reality is, how tired do we have to get? You know, that's the real question. I do believe eventually we will get tired of it, but how tired do we have to get? Well, that's a personal decision, and each of you are faced with that personal decision. How tired are you going to get before you change? And you can see that for each person, that's quite a different answer, isn't it? Some people will tolerate far higher degrees of pain and suffering than others will, for whatever reasons they have for doing that. Does that make sense? So in terms of collectively, will all of humanity embrace, is your question, God's laws? Will all of humanity embrace God's laws? Well, I don't know. It's hard one to guess. They've got to see the motivation for it. They've got to see the outcomes. They've got to see. So there's quite a lot of things that have to happen before that's potentially a possibility. But there are also, if a few of us get into the state where we can illustrate and practically illustrate the benefits of following God's laws, then obviously there might be a higher motivation for humanity then to go along with that, what's being illustrated. Does it make sense?
Thank you. Yeah. Do we need to embrace our injuries about parental authority before we can embrace God's laws?
Yes, we do. Is really the answer. You can see from our three discussions that we had about human law, the comparison and the attitudes and emotions and the hangover, that a lot of this is all about the fact that right from a young child we have desensitized our hearts to the concept that parental authority has been abusive in some way, and as a result we then have carried this over into the way we treat law. And so we are going to have to open our hearts to the harm that was perpetrated during the childhood experience that has harmed our perception of God's laws and harmed our desire to obey them. And it's in particular our desire to obey them that needs to be adjusted, because that's where our pain and suffering begins. We desire to disobey, which is sin, and sin then results in the consequential pain and suffering. So yes, we are going to need to actually deal with the issues regarding parental authority and the injuries we have there if we're truly going to be able to embrace God's laws.
Thank you.
Yeah.
AJ, can I just ask a quick question? It was me who left the phone on and I'd forgotten to turn it off. Is that me having an unloving, even though it was unconscious or not?
Well, it's just you not doing a check each morning to see whether your phone is off before you bring it here. That's all it is. So my question to you would be, why don't you do that check? You know, it's a mistake you made, but it was driven by the fact that you're not thorough. So have a look at why you're not thorough before you come.
Yeah.
That's all you need to do.
Thank
Make
you.
Sense?
Yeah. Yep.
Okay, Felix, where are you? Yep, if we could have Felix with the mic, your question one could we have? Thank you.
I'll just find it. Sorry.
It's all right. It's the one, is the only difference between...
Is the only difference between punishment and penalty, as you're using the terms, that one is... like penalty, as God uses it, does not have, anger, and the aim is my happiness, or everybody's happiness.
Yeah, very good question. Yeah. And the answer is yes. Penalty, the way I'm using it, has no punitive, rageful-based connotation. Mm. It's only a correction for the breaking of the law. So with God, everything is about, with God's laws, everything is about attempting to correct your behavior to bring it into harmony with love, right? That's the underlying purpose of God's laws. And so there's no punitive action in it, in the sense that it's trying to make you hurt or trying to make you suffer.
Mm.
It's not none of that. It's trying to bring you to awareness is its underlying goal.
Yeah.
Whereas human law is often the opposite. There is this, penalty associated with it, but often there is also the rage of people or the rage of society imposed upon it. And this is where it can get quite punitive and quite harsh, where collective groups of people demonstrate all of their rage and anger about what the person has done, and then that person has to deal with the rage and anger along with the fact that they've done the thing and try to find the cause. So God's way of addressing a problem is very, very different than humans' way of addressing a problem. And we need to see the concept of God's of penalty. It's all just about, no, every law has a consequence for breaking it and a consequence for living in harmony with it. The consequence for living in harmony is going to bring happiness and bliss. The consequence for living out of harmony is going to create pain and suffering naturally. Yeah.
Can I ask another quick question about that?
Yeah, if I approve it, go ahead. Skip it.
Sorry,
that's all right. Let's go to Dave. Where's Dave? Yep. So Dave, if we could have your question. Just let me just check my timings. Yep, 6 minutes. Yep.
How do we stop or even grow a desire to stop treating God's laws the same as we do human laws?
Yeah, that's the question, isn't it, really? How do we stop or grow a desire to stop treating God's laws the same as I do human laws? What do you reckon? What do I have to do here? If we maybe bring the mic down to Susan and on across to Diana on this side. So what do I do? How do I grow a desire to stop treating God's laws?
Basically do what you've been teaching.
Yes, which was in the first group, wasn't it? Remember, yeah, we talked about aspiration. How do you develop aspiration? Can you remember? Can't remember the details.
No, I can't. And
this is the trouble, isn't it? We don't remember the details of some quite things that are quite important sometimes. So the details of developing an aspiration we covered in the first group about how do you change your desire? How do you do it? Remember Graham Sutherland asked some of the questions about how do I know I want to do the wrong thing. What do I do about that? How do I change that? And we went through a whole series of things there about how to change that. So my suggestion, Dave, is to go back to that discussion and have a look at the Q&A there. I think we've tagged most of it properly. Go back to the Q&A there, Dave, and have a look at that. But my suggestion to all the group is to go back to that and write down that procedure, because that's the procedure you want to remember. It's something we need to do with regard to law, isn't it? We need to change it so that we stop what we want. We want to stop what we're doing, and we want to start a different thing. That's what we need to do. So there's two desires that have got to be developed. Firstly, the desire to stop, right? And what we're doing, which, by the way, as we've already pointed out, remember the discussion with Natalie and Adam was about anger. Remember we talked about how anger often is driving our behavior here with regard to law. So we have to, obviously, we're going to need to address some of those. And that means having a desire to no longer live in our anger, and a desire to instead release what drives our anger so that we no longer live in it. And then on the other hand, even after we've done all that, it still doesn't mean we're going to be doing the right thing yet. We then have to develop a desire to start treating God's laws differently. And that's going to be another desire that has to be developed from within ourselves. But again, nobody else can control that for you. That's something you're going to need to do through your actions. Now, we described to Graham in that process what those actions are that need to be taken. So instead of re-answering the question here, I'd like to refer you back to that discussion and ask you to have a good look at that discussion again, because that's the answer to your question. Does that make sense? Yep. Good day. If we can come across to Jada again. Yep. So this one's question three now, Jada.
Do you feel adding positive compensation to human law obedience would have a positive benefit? And what would this look like?
Yes, I do believe it would have a great positive benefit. You imagine if you had a positive motivation as well as a penalty association with any law, then of course you're probably going to want to obey the law. Now, you know, politicians are into giving tax cuts, right? Okay, well, here's an idea of a good tax cut. You give a tax cut to the people who have paid their taxes regularly and honestly for the last 10 years or 20 years or whatever. Right? And no other person. Now, the only problem with that kind of idea is that you probably will be voted out of office with it. Because everybody wants their tax cut, not just the people who honestly paid their taxation, you see. So this is where everybody would need to accept the decision and not base their future choices of politicians on the decision that was being made and see that it's actually a just decision. Of course it's a just decision, isn't it? Give the people who have been supporting society the most the tax cuts, and the people who are supporting society the least, don't give them the tax cuts. Isn't that wise? A wise way? There's a reward system in that. So these kind of rewards can be posted across a lot of things. For example, another reward system just with driving. At the moment, all you get is you get assigned 12 points, and then, or I think it's 12, isn't it, in your driving. And then if you speed or you do this, you lose 3 points, or you lose this, that, do that, and you lose 3 points. And if you lose your 12 points, then you've lost your license. Isn't that about the thing? I'm not up with it, but I think that's about the thing. Now imagine if you got caught doing everything good and you got points added, rather than just points taken away, right? So you've got a buffer if you make a mistake then, because of you doing the good thing, and one time you might make a mistake. Now, sometimes it's easy to make a mistake, isn't it? You're driving along, you know, and you're maybe talking, or your attention's a bit distracted or whatever from something, and you don't see the sign that just went past, and so you don't slow down, and then you get caught, right? Sometimes it's like that, isn't it, when you get caught? It's a mistake. It's not, you know, you're not purposely, you normally obey the law, but sometimes you make mistakes. If you had this buffer system that you were rewarded for the previous behaviours of long-term, you know, support of the law, then it wouldn't matter to you, would you? You wouldn't be worried about losing points by mistake, right? You'd just be concentrating still on just obeying the law because you want to obey the law. There's a physical example with regard to speeding. Does that make sense? So there's plenty of examples we could come up. You can analyse every law and change every law to give a reward, actually. Yeah. And I feel, yes, it would have a great effect on humanity's desire to actually obey the law rather than not. Yeah. Yeah. It's a good question, though, Jenna. Yeah. Okay, next person. I'm just a bit over time, so I just want to make sure that I've answered the most of the ones I want to ask. I think there were two others I wanted to answer, which were from Kelly and Suzanne, but they're quite long answers, so I don't have the time to give them. I'm sorry, girls. So, but both were good questions, and we'll try to answer them in our studio when we get to answering these questions there. All right, guys, well, thank you again for your time. We're now going to look at some principles after the lunch period. The last principle of the order series is going to be the compensation principles, which many of you are worried about. So we're going to discuss those principles. So if we can make it back at 10 to 1, I think it is, that we've got scheduled for that. Yep, 10 to 1 is the time. And we'll get started, 10 to 2, and we'll get started on those compensation principles. Thanks, guys.